Hello everyone, let's discuss pressure drawdown, diagnostic plots, type curves and gas well testing in this particular session. Coming to pressure drawdown testing, pressure drawdown test is simply a series of bottom hole pressure measurements made during a period of flow at a constant producing rate. Usually the well is shut in prior to the flow test for a period of time sufficient to allow the pressure to equalize throughout the formation, that is to reach static pressure. Alright, so over here, this is my drawdown period. Okay, this is my drawdown, and this is the bottom hole pressure that I am recording while drawdown test. And it should be taken into consideration that I will have to shut the well prior to drawdown so that I can get a equalized pressure throughout the formation. That is, I should have a static pressure throughout the formation prior to the drawdown test. It's a very important thing to be taken into consideration. Information derived from the test, let's look at it. Permeability, skin factor, reservoir drainage volume, flow efficiency, distance to linear no flow barrier, and type of reservoir boundary. We will discuss these things in coming up slides. Coming to advantages, there will be no loss in the production, no loss in revenue, whereas in pressure buildup we shut the well. Okay, over here we are not shutting the well, that means we are allowing the well to flow, whereas when we were talking about pressure buildup, at that time we were shutting the well to record the shut-in pressures. Okay, so that's one of the major advantage of a pressure drawdown test. Coming to disadvantage, it is difficult to flow the well at constant Q. Erroneous data are obtained since our well is flowing continuously, and while flowing only I will have a pressure recorder in the well bore. Okay, so these reservoir fluids that come into the well bore are flowing with some velocity, and because of that it creates high amount of disturbances in the pressure recorders. The sensors present in the pressure recorder will record noises, high amount of noise because of this flowing well. Third point is, it does not determine P average. Reservoir pressure cannot be determined by using drawdown test. Now let's look at the formula. Over here formula is PWF is equal to PI minus 162.6 Q mu B upon KH into log KT upon 5 mu CT R square minus 3.23 plus 0.87. We have derived this equation, okay, in the previous session. We have seen that from diffusivity equation by using EI solution I got the log approximation. Okay, from that I derived this particular formula when I had X or the log approximation value less than 0.01. For this case I derived this particular thing. Okay, in this particular formula my K is the permeability, T is the time for hour, RW is the wellbore radius, and skin S is the skin factor. Okay, for more details please visit my last video. Now so this particular equation can be written as PWF is equal to PI minus 162.6 Q mu B upon KH since it is log. Okay, as we know log AB can be written as log A plus B. So what I did is that I have expanded this. See, log T plus log K 5 mu CT R square minus 3.23 plus 0.87. I've just expanded it. Okay. Now this particular equation can be written as a straight line equation. Okay. Now where my A is my intercept. My intercept can be written as this form. Okay. What I did is that very simply I have just taken out my intercept value and my slope. The slope of the straight line equation can be given by minus 162.6 Q mu B upon KH. Okay. Oh, a very important point to be taken into consideration over here is that my slope for a drawdown test will be negative in nature. Whereas when we were talking about pressure buildup, at that time we had seen that my slope for a buildup test is positive in nature. Okay. So please take special note. Now let's move further. Over here you can see that I have a semi log plot of a pressure drawdown. So it is flowing bottom hole pressure versus time. Okay, so you can see that initially, okay, again this is a straight line. Okay, this is the straight line over here. Now what does this straight line mean? That means the equation that we have derived, okay, the equation that we have, and whatever assumptions and limitation we had taken during derivation of the particular equation, it suits best, okay, in this straight line. Okay, that means whatever points lie in that particular straight line, it satisfies that particular assumptions or a limitation that we were using while deriving the equation. Now, in the early time, see, this is my early time region, this will be my mid time region, and this will be my late time region. So in the early time region, there is an obvious deviation from the straight line. This is caused by skin and Velbo storage effect. Okay, I have discussed this in detail when we were discussing pressure buildup. Now coming to mid time region, you can see that in mid time region, primarily you will have a radial flow. Okay, so this can be termed as a transient flow region. Why transient flow region? That means my pressure pulse has not yet reached the boundary. We have already seen that in my first session of well test, we have seen type of reservoir flow. In type of reservoir flow, we have discussed steady state, semi steady state, or the pseudo steady state, and transient flow. And in transient flow, we had said that when my pressure pulse has not yet reached the boundary, at that time we can say that it is a transient flow. Okay, so let me discuss it once again. So I have a well bore and I have boundary. Okay, transient flow means my pressure pulse has not yet reached the boundary. See, it is yet to reach the boundary. And in transient flow region, I have my dp by dt as a function of distance and time. We have discussed this earlier also. So this particular point will be my end of the transient flow. Okay, so end of the transient flow indicates that my pseudo steady state region will begin. So I can say that my pressure pulse, start of the pseudo steady state, that means my pressure pulse has reached the boundary. Okay, when my pressure pulse reaches the boundary, once it reaches the boundary, then it follows a definite trend of a pseudo steady state region. Okay, if it is following pseudo steady state region, I have different set of formulas. I will discuss those things in detail. Now this is the formula again: PW is equal to PI minus 162.6 Q mu B upon KH into log KT upon 5 mu CT R square minus 3.23 plus 0.87. Now I know my slope will be negative. Okay, from that I can find permeability. Again, a very important point, I am finding the effective permeability of over here. Okay, I am getting an effective permeability. Now M is my slope in psi per cycle. Okay, note my slope M is negative in nature. So from this, if I have the slope value, I can definitely find my kh by mu, where kh by mu is my transmissibility. Okay, if I have the slope value M, I can find the transmissibility also. And what is transmissibility? I have already discussed in my earlier session. Refer my well test part 1 session. Now skin is equal to 1.151, pressure at 1 hour minus pressure, initial pressure upon M, minus log K upon 5 mu CT R square plus 3.23. okay, again P 1 hour means after my, at this point, see, at this point, this is my P 1 hour. Look, this is my P 1 hour. Okay, and my P initial, if I want to plot my P initial, then P initial will be this point. Okay, starting of the drawdown test, at that time that would be my P initial, minus log K upon 5 mu CT R square plus 3.23. Alright, okay, now let's move further. This is for flow versus time, and so initially you can see that this is initial, I will get my transient flow only at this point. I will get at this point only, I will start with my semi steady state or my PSS flow. Now you can see that initially I will be having after flow fractures and skin, and late time region. Okay, I may get a straight line over here. This is for a gas well pressure. Okay, so I will get a straight line, some sort of a straight line. From that I can go for identifying the reservoir properties. Like for example, I will get the slope value. From slope value I can identify my effective permeability. And in the late time region, my drawdown test is amenable to analysis by semi-steady state condition. Okay, if initially during early time flow, wellbore storage and skin effects dominate the flow. When the well is opened at the surface for a flow at a constant rate, the initial flow comes primarily from the wellbore itself rather than from the formation. We have already seen that in my wellbore storage session. In fact, flow from the reservoir increases gradually from zero until the specified wellhead flow rate Q is reached in a length of time. Obviously, we have seen this. Transient flow regime. In this flow regime, the pressure is the same as that created by a line source well with a constant skin. The semi-log analysis of drawdown data yields consistent values of reservoir parameters. Only the permeability thickness KH, the skin factor and the initial turbulence factor D may be determined from such analysis. This semi-log straight line continues as long as the reservoir is infinite acting. Alright, when I am having a transient flow regime, that means my reservoir will act as if it is infinite in nature. That means it has no boundary. Coming to pseudo steady state flow regime, when a constant rate drawdown test is run for a long period of time, the boundary effects eventually dominate the pressure behavior at the well. The pressure starts declining at the same rate at all the points in the reservoir, hence the name pseudo steady state. If the flow extends to the pseudo steady state, the test is referred to as reservoir limit test, or commonly termed as RLT, reservoir limit test, and can be used to estimate in place gas and shape of the reservoir. Okay, in place gas or is the in place oil? Okay, that means hydrocarbon in place can be found out if I am going for RLT. Coming to semi log plot, you can see that I plotted my flowing bottom hole pressure versus log of time. Okay, so this is a semi log plot for a drawdown case. Near wellbore region, you can see that I will be having wellbore storage effect coefficient and my well skin. The midtime region will be the representative part of my reservoir, and the outer boundary will be indicating my pressure support, or how will be the boundary for my reservoir. Now you can see that if I am having a variation in the skin, for skin 0, if I am having skin 0, then I will get a straight line. Okay, that means whatever ideal straight line I am getting by using the equation, if I am having a skin 0 case, at that time it will follow that particular straight line. But if there is skin less than 0, at that time this trend will be followed, and if my skin is greater than 0, at that time this particular trend will be followed. Alright, okay, you can see that why there is this deviation in the curves. Again, for a look at this particular figure, I have my pressure profile over here. Okay, pressure profile. Now you can see that for an ideal skin, I will be having some this kind of a pressure profile. Okay, that means this will be my delta P ideal. This will be my delta P ideal. Delta P ideal when my skin is 0. Okay, now if I am having skin greater than 0, you can see that my delta P would be higher, pressure drop will be higher, so that will be my delta P actual. And again, we know my delta P actual will be equal to delta P ideal plus delta P skin. We have already discussed it many times now. So when we are having skin greater than 0, my delta P pressure drop will be higher. I'm having skin less than 0, at that time my delta P actual will be less. Okay, all right so that's why we are able to see some kind of this kind of a pressure disturbances when I'm having different type of skin. Now let's look at when I'm having different type of a wellbore storage, at that time how does my trend differs. So you can see that C1 over here shows this is my C1 trend. Okay, in this particular figure, in this wellbore storage figure, you can see that this is my trend. Okay, so this is for C1 trend and this is for C2 trend. That means my C2 is having more wellbore storage time and C1 is having less wellbore storage time. Okay, so this is how the wellbore storage will affect the trend. Again, midtime region, I will be having the representative part of my reservoir, and I can use it for identifying what will be my effective permeability. I can identify what will be my transmissibility, etc. Now coming to outer boundaries, I can find that if it have a constant pressure boundary, okay, or if it follows my pseudo steady state condition, at that time my trend would be something like this. Okay, almost straight line. After my midtime region, it will follow a straight line with slope 0. Now let's say if it is following that same trend, whatever trend it was having in my midterm region, if it is following the same trend, that means it has not yet reached the boundary, and it can be termed as an infinite acting reservoir. Let's say if my line, if my trend goes down, start getting down, okay, that means if my slope is increasing continuously after my midterm region, at that time I can term into conclusion that I have a fault nearby or I have a closed reservoir. All right, so I have discussed three cases. One case is, so let me summarize it once again. So for a pseudo steady state condition, after my midtime region, my trend will be a straight line with slope zero. If my midtime region's trend and my late time region trend is the same, then I can say that my it is a infinite acting reservoir. And if from the midtime region trend, if my slope is getting increased or my trend is going down and down, that time I can say that I have a fault or I am dealing with a closed reservoir boundary. Okay.
Now this is a very important gate concept, and this particular question has been asked in gate. Now let's look at this. I have discussed this particular case for a pseudo steady state condition or a PSS condition. I have discussed, that means dp by dt is equal to constant at any distance r. Now again, obvious, my pressure over here now throughout my delta p will be same, okay, and delta p1, delta p2, delta p3, and with time my pressure will go down because of depletion. All right, okay. Now again, if I am taking at t1, if I am recording p1 as my boundary pressure, that this will be the p1 at time t1, this is my p1, p2 at boundary, p3 at boundary, and p4 at boundary. Okay, so you can represent that p1, p2, p3, p4. So at the boundary also, whatever pressure I am recording, it will go down, which is again obvious, okay, with time because of depletion. This particular process is because of depletion, my pressure is going down. Now let's look at this concept, a very important numerical over here, a very important concept rather. So as we know, my C or the compressibility equal to 1 upon V minus 1 upon V upon into dV by dP. Now if I am rearranging my C into V into dP is equal to minus dV. If I am taking dV as my subject of equation, I will get this. Now differentiating with respect to time, I will get my CV into dP by dT equal to dV by dT. Now dV by dT is equal to my flow rate. Now taking dP by dT as the subject of equation, I will get minus Q by CV. Alright, now expressing this decline rate, that is dP by dT decline rate, in PSI per hour. Okay, now if I want to express it in PSI per hour, what I will do is that I will divide by 24. Okay, now once I divide by 24, this is what I will get the expression, where dP by dT is equal to minus Q by 24 into CV. Okay, this is in reservoir condition. Now if I want to express it in stock tank condition, I will multiply VO. Alright, now this V over here, capital V, is my pore volume. Again, we know for pore volume, that means for a drainage or radial drainage in the system, my pore volume is V is equal to pi R square H upon 5.615. okay, now if I'm talking about a radial case, let's say this is my radial case and this is my wellbore, and RE means my radius of the reservoir. Okay, RE over here, RE means my radius of the reservoir, H means my height of the radial reservoir, 5 means my porosity, divided by 5.615 is my conversion factor. So if I place this, my area will be in feet square, H will be in feet. Alright, okay, now placing this V, whatever expression we obtained from V, I am placing it in the dP by dT term. So my final answer would be dP by dT is equal to minus 0.2339 into Q upon CT into H5. Okay, this is a very, very important concept. This particular question concept has been asked in GATE. Now let's discuss the diagnostic plots. Diagnostic plot is a log-log plot of the pressure change and the pressure derivative on the vertical axis from a pressure transient test versus the elapsed time or in the horizontal axis. Okay, over here, that means my dP by d of ln t into delta t. Okay, this would be on my y axis and log t would be on the x axis. Again, both are in logarithmic in nature, hence it is called as a log-log plot. Now the logarithmic derivative is highly sensitive to subtle variations in the shape of the drawdown or my build-up curve. It allows detecting the behaviors that are difficult to observe on the drawdown or build-up curve alone. The diagnostic plot can be divided into three time regions, early, mid and late. At the earliest time regions on a plot, Velbor and near Velbor effects dominate. These effects include Velbor storage, formation damage, partial penetration, phase distribution, and stimulation. At the intermediate times or at the midtime region, a reservoir will ordinarily be infinite acting. For a homogeneous reservoir, the pressure derivative will be horizontal during this time region. Data in this region lead to most accurate estimates of the formation permeability. At the late time region, boundary effects dominate the curve shapes. This type of boundaries that may affect the pressure response, including ceiling faults, closed reservoirs. Alright, now so this is how a diagnostic plot will typically look like. So this particular region over here is my early time region. This is my early time region, this will be my mid time region, and this is my late time region. So you can see that this is my derivative of pressure. Okay, pressure derivative over here, and this is my pressure over here. So dp upon d ln td into td. Okay, so this is my pressure derivative one, this is my pressure change, and versus log time. Okay, so this is my log log plot over here. Now, so in the initially I will have slope equal to 1. When I'm getting this unit slope unit of unity, at that time I can say that this particular region, the time till which I get slope equal to 1 in a diagnostic plot, I will term it as my Velbor storage time. Okay, and the time when my slope deviates from the slope equal to 1, at that time it can be termed as my end of Velbor storage. Now you can see that my diagnostic plots over here. Okay, in this time, okay, whenever I'm getting slope equal to 1, at this time both my diagnostics, see, this is my diagnostic plot, this green color I'm indicating my diagnostic plot or the derivative plot, see, and this red color one I'm indicating the pressure change. See, this is my pressure change curve, whereas the green color one was my derivative plot. Okay, so in the slope, till my slope equal to 1, okay, both my derivative as well as my pressure change plot were following the same trend. And after that, at the end of the Velbor storage, both my pressure change and my derivative started to deviate from each other. So you can see that after my end of Velbor storage, I can see a definite rise over here, and then it will fall down. Okay, graph goes down. If the slope is equal to minus 1/2, then it will be a spherical flow. Again, we have seen that when I am having a partial penetration, at that time I will experience spherical flow because of flow convergence. We will discuss this thing in detail in coming up slide. So as of now, let's see that. See, you can see that my trend is going down with slope minus half. When I am having minus half, then I can say that it will be my spherical flow. After that, in the diagnostic plot or the derivative plot, so this is my end of my early time. Okay, this point is the end of the early time, and now this particular point over here can be termed as my start of the radial flow. Okay, that means this is the start of my midtime region, and in my midtime region, my slope of the derivative plot will be a zero. Okay, you can see that my slope is zero over here. Between the pressure plot versus my diagnostic plot, this height would be a representative of skin. Okay, now you can see that, let me take an example over here. Let's say this is my diagnostic plot and this is my pressure change plot. Okay, now for different cases I am discussing. Let's say I am having for different skin factor, if I am talking about, I know that this difference would be, the height would be because of skin. Okay, so let's say if I am plotting, if I'm having higher skin, that means if I'm having this kind of trend, that means this is for increasing skin. Okay, let's say if I am plotted for different skin values, okay, and the more the height I am having from the diagnostic plot, that can say that my skin factor is high. Okay, so this particular trend is for increasing skin. Let's say this was for skin 0, let's say this is for skin 1, this is for skin 2, this is for skin 5, and this will be for skin 10. Okay, for increasing value of skin, this height or the difference between the diagnostic plot trend and the pressure change trend will be rising. Okay, and again in the midtime region, I will be having a radial flow region. Now coming to the late time region over here. In my late time region, I can have three different cases.
if let's say if my trend follows the same as my midtime region, that means if my slope is still zero, that means my boundary has not yet reached, or else I can say that my reservoir is infinite acting. Now if my slope is negative, or my slope is negative one, at that time I can say that I have a steady state condition. That means if I am getting a negative slope, a steady state condition means my dp by dt equal to zero. That means my reservoir pressure will remain the same throughout any time, and at any point in the life of the reservoir, my pressure will remain the constant, and it will not decline with time. Now if I am having a, in the late time region, if I am having a straight line with slope positive one, or a positive slope with value of one, at that time I can say that my pseudo steady state condition has been achieved. That means my dp by dt equal to constant term has achieved. That's how my late time region will differ in this diagnostic plot. Okay, now again, my late time region will be an indicative of the type of boundary that I am having in the reservoir. All right, okay, now let's move further. Now let's discuss various cases where I am having different kind of a reservoir, or different kind of attributes in the reservoir. For, and when I am having those kind of attributes, how does my diagnostic plot or the derivative plot changes? So this particular first case is for when I am having an infinite conductivity vertical fracture. That means I will be having no pressure drop losses across the fracture length. At that time, this will be my trend. Okay, that means in the initial stage only I will be having slope of one airflow, or I am talking about an infinite conductivity vertical fracture case. Now coming to when I am having a finite conductivity vertical fracture case, let's discuss what does it mean. Over here you can see that for a fracture, okay, initially this is my wellbore, this is my fracture, let this be the width of the fracture and let this be the fracture half length. You can see that inside the fracture I am having a fracture linear flow. Now so there will be reservoir fluids which are being fed from the reservoir, okay, and this will be linear in nature. So from the formation to the fracture it will flow linearly, and inside the fracture also my reservoir fluid will flow linearly. Okay, so it has been termed bilinear. Okay, now so from the, so this is my formation linear. Again, as I mentioned that my flow will be flowing in the near wellbore region, my flow will be having a linear flow. Okay, and so hence it is termed as formation linear. And now with at some distance away from my wellbore, I will be having a radial flow. Okay, so this is a pseudo radial flow. Now coming to the diagnostic plot, you can see that initially I will be having this is my wellbore storage effect, where m equal to 1 is indicative of wellbore storage, and at this point my pressure change as well as my pressure derivative will be following the same trend. After that my pressure change curve and my pressure derivative will take some deviation from each other. You can see that when I'm having, again as we have mentioned, that initially I will be having fracture linear, then bilinear, then formation linear, then radial flow. So you can see for a fracture linear my slope will be m equal to half, for bilinear my slope will be 1/4, for formation linear my slope will be half, and for a radial flow my slope would be completely zero. Okay, so this is how you differentiate different kind of flow regime. So you can see that fracture linear my slope is half, bilinear 1/4, formation linear it is half, and for radial flow it is zero, the slope value I'm talking about. So this is a log-log plot for a fractured well for a finite conductivity vertical fracture condition. Okay, this was for a infinite conductivity vertical fracture. Infinite conductivity means my, I am assuming that my fracture length is such, the length of the fracture is so high that it will act as an infinite conductivity system. All right, okay, now let's move further. Now coming to this case where I am having a partial penetrating well, at this time again I mentioned this earlier also, let this be my height of the perforation, okay, and let this be the total height of the reservoir. And as we know that in the midtime region I will be having radial flow, okay, at some distance far away from the wellbore I will be having radial flow. But since my perforation over here are very partial in nature, or are very limited, you can see that my flow has begin to converge. Okay, so because of this converging nature I will be having a spherical type of flow near the wellbore. And I can see in the early time region, when I'm plotting the derivative plot at that time, in the early time region, I can see this kind of a trend over here. At the later portion of my early time region, you can see that when I'm having a slope of minus half, it will be indicating me a spherical flow. Talk about a case when I'm having a horizontal well. Now you can see that, this is how my flow will flow. Let this be the horizontal well, okay. So my flow will flow from the 360 degree. My flow will try to enter my wellbore. So that means initially I will be having a early radial flow. Some distance from the wellbore, I can have a linear flow. You can see that my flow is coming into the wellbore linearly. Okay. And farther away from the wellbore, I will be obviously having my radial flow. Okay. Now, so this will be the three flow regimes that I will be experiencing when I am having a horizontal well. Now, let us represent this same thing in my diagnostic plot. Now, when I am representing this same thing in my diagnostic plot, you can say that, as I mentioned, early radial flow will be represented by a initially zero slope, okay, horizontal line, and then I will get, since I mentioned that at some distance from the horizontal portion, I will be experiencing linear flow. So my slope of diagnostic plot will be half, and more distance farther away from the wellbore, I will again experience radial flow. So hence I will again get a horizontal line with slope equal to zero. Now in the midtime region, when I'm talking about, you can say that when I'm having a horizontal line in the midtime region or a slope equal to zero, at that time I am having homogeneous radial acting reservoir. Okay, that means whatever assumptions, whatever limitation that I have taken into consideration when I'm going for derivation of my pressure buildup or my pressure drawdown, it satisfies the particular curve. Okay, when I'm having slope equal to zero, so you can see that in my midtime region I will be experiencing a homogeneous radial flow. Now coming to naturally fractured reservoir, as I mentioned earlier also, my NFRs, naturally fractured reservoir, will have two systems, my fracture system as well as my matrix system. Okay, now I have seen this in my Horner time discussion also. This will be my kind of slope that I will be obtaining. Okay, that means I will be obtaining two parallel lines with similar slope. Okay, so initially I will be having fracture flow, then I will be having a transition from the fracture to matrix, and the end time region or the late time region will be having my matrix plus fissure flow or my fracture flow. And this is how NFRs will show trend in my diagnostic plots. So initially when I am having a fissure flow, at that time slope equal to zero, horizontal line I will be obtaining. For a transition flow, I will be seeing a negative hump over here. See, I have seen a hump over here. So this is my transition period, and after that, in the late time region, I can see that my matrix plus fissure flow is obtained. When I again start to obtain my horizontal line with slope zero. Okay, so this is how diagnostic plot can be seen in a naturally fractured reservoir. Let's move further. Discuss this particular point that pressure behavior of a closed system is totally different when I'm having a drawdown and a buildup periods. Okay, that means drawdown derivative, when all the ceiling boundaries are reached, both the pressure and the derivative curve follow a unit slope, n equal to 1, straight line. On the specialized Cartesian plot, P versus time, the flowing pressure is a linear function of time. That means for a drawdown case, when I'm having a closed reservoir or a closed system, that means I am having no additional support from outside, at that time both my pressure as well as my derivative curve follows a straight line with slope equal to 1. You can see that over here. See, my drawdown, for the drawdown case, both my pressure as well as my derivative plot follows a straight line with slope 1. But when I am talking about a buildup derivative, when all the ceiling boundaries are reached, the pressure tends to stabilize at the average reservoir pressure, P average. And as a consequence, the derivative curve drops. Now you can see that for a buildup curve, that is indicated by this red line, in the late time region, my pressure remains stabilized. pressure curve will be stabilized, that means slope will be zero, but my derivative plot will drop. Okay, so this is a characteristic that I will be this is a distinct characteristic that I will find when I'm having a closed reservoir, and this is the changes that I will be observing when I'm having a drawdown derivative and a build up derivative. Let's say my reservoir is having support over here. I am having aquifer, okay, and I am having a constant support. So if any of the side acts as a constant pressure boundary due to water drive support, the log-log response curves tends to stabilize and then derivative drops. So you can see that this is the, in this case I am having, this case you can see that my derivative plot will drop. When I'm having a constant pressure case, my derivative plot will drop at the late time region. But when we were talking in a closed reservoir, again let me repeat, this is a derivative plot. Okay, in a derivative plot I can have it, either it can fall down, it will move straight, or it will move up. When it is falling down, that means I'm having a constant pressure support. When it is moving up, that means I am talking about a closed reservoir, or I am talking about a case when I am having no support. Or if it is following the same trend as before, that means it is an infinite acting, that means my boundary has hasn't yet reached. Let's move further. Okay, these are the near wellbore effects. I can have wellbore storage, skin fractures, partial penetration and horizontal well trends. Early times I will obtain these near wellbore effects. Coming to reservoir behavior that I obtain in the midtime region are homogeneous system. We have seen that if at all there is heterogeneity, two porosity, two permeability composite. Okay, two porosity, two permeability, we have discussed that in case of my naturally fractured reservoirs. Composite I have discussed in my honor time, when I have perforated in three, let's say stratified layers. Okay, at that time I will be having some disturbance in the midtime region. Coming to the boundary effects, which are generally found in the late time region of the curve, I can have a pressure difference in pressure. Okay, I can have a constant pressure, I can have a no pressure or a zero pressure boundary. Okay, constant pressure boundary, or I can have a, let's say, closed boundary, or I am having no pressure from outside. I can have a leaky boundary, or I can flow at some specific rate. Okay, so these are the three times: early time, mid time and late time region, and correspondingly I obtain these kind of effects in my plots. Alright, okay, let's move further. Let's discuss type curves. Type curves are pre-plotted solution to the flow equation, such as the diffusivity equation, for a selected type of formation and a selected initial and boundary condition. A very important point over there and an important definition. These are the pre-plotted solution to the diffusivity equation, and I am solving this diffusivity equation for a selected type of a formation and for a selected initial and the boundary condition. Because the way they are plotted, it is convenient to compare the actual field data plotted on the same coordinates to the type curves. Okay, once we have data from the field, keep the scale of the field data in such a way that it matches the scale of my type curve. Okay, once I have the same scaled field data, then I can use the type curve to determine various conditions, or I can determine various parameters from my type curves. Okay, I have an example of it. We will discuss that in coming up slide. The results of this comparison frequently include qualitative and quantitative description of the formation and the completion properties of the tested well. Okay, once I have this similar scaled field data with the type curve, I can use that type curve to get my qualitative and quantitative descriptions of the formation as well as my wellbore completions. Now, you can see that over here, I have a mathematical model describing the flow of fluid through the porous and permeable media. Okay, which is my diffusivity equation. I have derived my diffusivity equation using my Darcy law, using my equation of state and using my continuity equation. Okay, now in the diffusivity equation, I will consider different boundary condition, flow types, wellbore and reservoir properties. And on considering different kind of a boundary condition and different kind of flow types, I can come up with different analytical solutions. I can come up with different finite difference approximation generated by reservoir simulators. Over here, I have a log log and a derivative
plot feature for a homogeneous infinite acting reservoir. Okay, now the equation deriving this particular type curve is my log PD, or where this is my dimensionless pressure equal to log TD minus log CD. Okay, where PD equal to TD upon CD, the equation governing this particular type curve. So you can see that I have this type curve available with me, which is having pressure or dimensionless pressure versus my TD versus TD CD, where my TD is my dimensionless time and CD is my dimensionless wellbore storage. CD equal to 5.615 C 2 phi H into phi CT R square. So on conversion, I will get 0.894 C upon phi H CT R square. Okay. Now, as I mentioned before, so in this particular, you can see that this red color graph that I am obtaining is my field curve. Okay. This red color is my field curve, and this one was my type curve. Now, after arranging my field curve, or if I am after plotting my field curve similar to the scale of my type curve, okay, then what I can do is that I can match your type curve. Okay, once I place this field curve on top of this type curve, and I can obtain the trend over here. Okay, that means I can match the type curve once I am able to properly superimpose my field curve with my type curve. I will get one match point out of it. Okay, so I will obtain my match point. Okay, and I will record my field data. So I will be having one match point, and from that match point, from the field curve, I will get 2 points, that is pressure and time. And from my type curve, from that match point only, I will get my PD and TD upon CD for this particular curve. Got it? Okay. So this is how you obtain points from, or this is how you obtain match point from field curve and type curve superimposition. Got it? Okay. So once I have this match point, I can use this match point to find out, let's say, what will be my dimensionless wellbore storage, which will be equal to this formula 0.894 C upon 5 H CT R square. Okay. Now again, we know my PD is equal to TD upon CD, and my dimensionless time equal to 60 plus 3.5 S into CD. Now to find out what will be the time of my end of wellbore storage, that will be equal to 2 lakh plus 12,000 into skin into C upon KH by mu, where KH by mu is my transmissibility. Okay, let me summarize it again. Once I am having a field data, I will first try to plot that field data with the same scale of my type curve. Once I have the similarly scaled field data, I will superimpose the field data onto my type curve. Okay. Now, after superimposing and finding out the appropriate match or appropriate superimposition, I will get a match point. Once I have a match point, from the match point, I will obtain my pressure and time corresponding to both my type curve as well as my field curve. Okay. And once I have these 2 points, I can identify any kind of a parameter. Alright, okay, now let's move further. I have a numerical related to this particular type curve. Before discussing this numerical, I should discuss this thing. Okay, for a drawdown case, I can see that initially there is a drop in my pressure. Okay, there is a difference in the drop in pressure. This drop in my wellbore pressure causes the following two types of wellbore storage. One is my fluid expansion, and second is my changing fluid level in the casing tubing annulus. Now, wellbore storage effect due to my fluid expansion can be given by this, where C is equal to volume of wellbore into compressibility of the fluid in the wellbore. Talking about my wellbore storage factor caused by the changing fluid level, I have this formula which represents this changing fluid level wellbore storage factor, where 144 into A, which is my area of my wellbore fluid to be, that can be occupied, in divided by 5.615 into density. Okay, where density I will be placing it in pound per feet cube. Alright, now using this, let me solve a particular numerical over here. The following data is given for an oil well that is scheduled for a drawdown test. Volume of the fluid in the wellbore is given as 180 barrel. Tubing outside diameter is 2 inch. Production casing
ID is my 7.675 inches and my average oil density in the wellbore is 45 pound per feet cube and rest all the given data. If the well is placed under a constant production rate, how long will it take for the wellbore storage effect to end? First, we need to find out the cross-sectional area as per the formula. We need to first find out the cross-sectional area of the annulus that I can obtain by this particular formula, that is area, that is pi into casing ID square minus tubing OD square. Okay, I will get my area as 0.2995. From that, I can identify what will be my wellbore storage effect due to the fluid expansion. I have to place my volume of the wellbore and my compressibility. Okay, volume of the wellbore, I have already got 180 barrels. Okay, 180 into 10 raised to 10 into 10 raised to minus 6, I will get 0.0018 barrel per psi. Once I have this, my wellbore storage due to falling fluid, if I need to find out, then I have this formula where C equal to 144A upon 5.165 into density. Okay, on placing all the values, I will get my falling fluid as 0.1705 barrel per psi. Now my total wellbore storage coefficient will be addition of both, that will give me 0.17225 barrel per psi. So to find out my end of wellbore storage, I have this formula. On placing all the values, my end of wellbore storage will be at 115 hours. Let's discuss gas well testing. I will be having three type of gas well testing. One is flow after flow back pressure test or FAFBT. Second is isochronal test and third is my modified isochronal test. Coming to flow after flow back pressure test, it uses all the stabilized data. The test consists of a series of flow rates commonly referred to as 4-point test. This test is performed by producing the well at a series of stabilized flow rates and obtaining the corresponding stabilized flowing bottom hole pressures. In addition, a stabilized shut-in bottom hole pressure is required for the analysis. So you can see that I have flowed this particular well at 4 different flow rates. And I will flow till my pressure gets stabilized, till I get the stabilized pressure reading. Alright, okay. My limitation over here is my length of time required to obtain stabilized data for low permeability gas reservoir is very difficult. Okay, for a low permeability gas reservoir, it takes a lot amount of time for this stabilizing of data. So that's why if a flow after flow back pressure test is generally not done in a low permeability gas reservoir. Alright. Coming to isochronal test, to overcome the need to obtain a series of stabilized flow rates required for flow after flow back pressure test for the flow to stabilize the well. Okay, to overcome this particular time taken for the stabilization, isochronal test was done. This test consists of producing the well at different flow rates with flowing periods of equal duration. Over here what I did is that I flowed the well for different flow rates, but the flow duration I kept it same. Okay, each flow period is separated by a shut-in period in which the shut-in bottom hole pressure is allowed to stabilize at essentially the average reservoir pressure. Okay, I flowed the well at similar flow duration, but the shut-in time that I had given at each case, I have given the time till it stabilize. For example, if I float the well for a Q1 flow rate for, let's say, for X amount of time, after that I will give a shut-in time. Okay, the shut-in time that I gave, I will try to give the shut-in time till my well or till my pressure gets stabilized. Okay, the test method is based on the principle that the radius of investigation is a function of flow period and not the flow rate. Thus, for equal flow periods, the same drainage radius is investigated in spite of the actual flow rates. Application is low permeability reservoir. Okay, over here the principle is very important. Over here, my radius of investigation, I have already discussed radius of investigation in my initial session. The radius of investigation in this case, we are assuming that it to be as a function of flow period and not the flow rate. Okay. So thus we are giving equal flow periods. That means we are investigating similar drainage radius in spite of changing flow rates. Alright, okay. So you can see that when I'm flowing the well at Q1 rate, see, my pressure will drop due to the shut in till my I will give the time of shut in till it gets stabilized. Again I am flowing, it will fall down, it will rise when I am giving shut in. For Q3 again it will go down, and the T3 shut in time that I am giving, it will again rise up. Okay, in this way my isochronal testing is done. Coming to modified isochronal test, for some low permeability wells the time required to obtain stabilized shut in pressures may be impractical. To overcome this particular limitation, a modification to the isochronal test by requiring equal shut in periods is given. The modified isochronal test is essentially the same as the isochronal test, except the shut in periods separating the flow periods are equal to or longer than the flow periods. Okay, over here again I have flown my well at similar flow period, and next what I did is that whatever shut in time that I am giving over here, okay, this shut in time are equal to whatever flow period I am giving, equal to or slightly more than what the flow period I have given. Okay, the modified isochronal test is less accurate than the isochronal method because the shut in pressure is not allowed to return to the average reservoir pressure. Okay, alright, now let's move further. Coming to the gas wells, if I am having two test point data at that time, I can have a Rawlins and Shelland method, or I can go for a John Blount and Glaze method. I have already discussed this thing in my nodal analysis IPR session, inflow performance relationship session. I have already discussed this. For talking about a Rawlins and Shelland method, this is the formula that governs the equation. Okay, where QG is equal to gas flow rate equal to C PR square minus PF square raised to N, where C is my flow coefficient and N is my flow exponent. I can have when I'm having the range of value of N 0.5, I can have a non-Darcy flow, and when my N is 1, I can have a Darcy flow. On taking log on both the sides, I can represent this particular equation in the form of log QG is equal to log C plus N into log PR square minus PF square. Okay, and the straight line equation can be written as this. Okay, so if I am having two test points, I can identify what will be my N, and I can identify what will be my N. Alright, okay, let's move further. Coming to John Blount and Glaze method, here you can see that this particular formula governs this particular concept. Now PR square minus PF square is equal to A into QG plus PB QG square. Now taking QG in the denominator, I will be left out with this term equal to A plus B into QG. Okay, on plotting this PR square minus PF square upon QG versus QG, I will get a straight line with intercept of A and slope of B. Now A is the degree of damage and B is the turbulence. Again, as we know that near the wellbore I will be having turbulence because my gas velocity near the wellbore is very high. As a result, I will experience turbulence. Okay, so from this straight line equation, I will get my, if I want to calculate my flow rate, okay, flow rate will be this, where flow rate equal to minus A plus or minus under root of A square plus AB PR square minus PF square upon 2B. So this is how you identify flow rate from this particular concept. Alright, now let's move further. Now this is again a very good concept, where in this, if you have a single test point at that time, we can use this particular concept. Okay, now over here for a gas well there are three regions that has been differentiated. Region 1, which in which the reservoir pressure lies between 0 to 2000 psi. In region 2, where the pressure lies between 2000 to 3000 psi, and in region 3, where the reservoir pressure lies above 3000 psi. Okay. Now, for all the three different regions, to get the flow rate, you have different equations. Like in region 3, this will be your flow rate, and it is almost similar. You can observe that this almost the equation is almost similar to that of an oil well. Okay, that means there is no square or pseudo function being used. In region 2, you use a pseudo function psi. Okay, this value, this pseudo function is used, and this pseudo pressure is a mathematical pressure function that accounts for the variable of z and viscosity of gas with respect to pressure. Okay, this pseudo pressure, what does it do is that, see, prove this over here. Okay, it takes into account pressure with changing in viscosity and z value. So pseudo pressure function is 2 times the integral 2 times p by mu z, where it has been integrated from 0 to p, and from that you can obtain that pseudo function of p can also be written as p I square minus p naught square upon mu z. All right. And for the region one, a pressure squared method is used to calculate the gas flow rate. All right. Now, why do we require this particular thing? That is, why only for a gas well? We are having these three different equations. Okay. For that, as we know, for an oil, the value of Z, viscosity, and density do not change significantly. Okay, this is very important term. It will change. ऐसा नहीं कि change नहीं होता, change तो होता है, but significant change नहीं मिलेगा. Okay, with changing pressure for an oil well, value of Z or viscosity or density ज़्यादा significantly change नहीं होता. But in comparison, for a gas well, the value of Z, viscosity and density changes very significantly. All right, and because of this thing, only at lower pressures, okay, at higher pressures it almost behaves like an oil well. That's not an issue, but at lower pressures, when the reservoir pressure is low, that is less than 3000 psi, at that time we need to if it lies between 2000 to 3000 psi, at that time we need to put up a pseudo pressure function. And for if the pressure is below 2000 psi, at that point we need to put up pressure squared function to calculate the gas flow rate. All right.
So that's all for today. Thank you. Jai Hind.